what you're able to live with is what the Lord has bestowed upon you. And what would truly destroy you, the Lord has never given you, even when it's good. That's what I believe. The day you're able to handle large caliber faith, you're going to have it. If you're not able to handle it, you're just not going to, it's not going to manifest. Why? Because the Lord gives us a measure of faith. He determines that. Not us. He does. To each of us has been given a measure of faith. It comes from Him. It doesn't come from anywhere else. That belief He put in you is knowledge and wisdom. He put that in you. It's up to Him how much you actually have. You have people in the world and they count themselves as smart. Oh, they're just geniuses. But what have they done? Geniuses in what? Creating businesses to make more money. That's what their geniuses are. That's it. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm going to start at 3. I knew such a man, whether in the body or out of the body, I cannot tell. God knoweth how that I was caught up into paradise and heard unspeakable words, which is not lawful for man to utter. I can truly understand that now. I didn't understand that a while ago. Of such and one will I glory. Yet of myself I will not glory. But in my infirmities, continue, follow me. For though I would desire to glory, I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. Listen, he says, for though I would desire to glory, I would desire to shine. I would desire to shine. I would desire to be known. I would desire to at least have some recognition. I shall not be a fool, for I will say the truth. But now I forbear, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be. Did you hear that? Now he's going to forbear, he's going to put up with all of what's happening to him, because if he doesn't, one would think of him being above a human being. He says, lest any man should think of me above that which he seeth me to be, or that he heareth of me. He says, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelations. That means the word he gives out, the things that are happening, he would be exalted. Which would take away from who? Christ. He would be exalted. He said, unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of revelations, there was given to me a thorn in my flesh, comma, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, than that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. What does that word strong means? As strong is directly related to effective. Thank you, Lord. Directly related to effectiveness. When he is weak or ineffective, Christ in him causes him to be highly effective. So he says, listen, okay, because I can relate to this. Some of you can relate to this. His position he's in right now. I can relate to that a little bit because my position is controversial. I could end that in 1 minute. I could end it all in 1 minute. It would no longer be controversial. But then at that point, it would no longer be about the word. Wouldn't it be about the person then? It wouldn't be about the word. It'd be about the person. Your credibility would change. Everything would change. It would look better. Everything would look better. But wouldn't that take away from the word? I most certainly think it would. Because then a whole new line of questions would come my direction. All sorts of new things would come that have nothing to do with Christ. Paul knew. And that's why the Lord said, my grace is sufficient for thee. In other words, trust the path I've laid before you. Continue to operate by these convictions. Don't make a move on your own. Paul said, I could have, and he could have survived it, but he did not want to be exalted above being a human being. So guess what? Paul was reproached. Paul was persecuted. People called him a charlatan, a beast. You name it, they called him a hypocrite, big time. Certain cities he could not go into. Those were his infirmities. Messengers of Satan to buffet are people who talk against those who house the gospel, who just make up stuff, who start rumors, all this stuff. So Paul said, I'm going to go ahead and deal with it. I could easily put that to rest, but I'm going to go ahead and deal with it. Ultimately, that Christ may be glorified. He's doing it for the sake of Christ. I think that's beautiful because he cares about the Lord. You see how he does not care about himself above the Lord? Because he knows that the Lord and the Lord's work is what saves man, not him. That is the thorn in his side. And does everybody clearly see what that thorn is? It's not a spouse. Paul wasn't going around with a big spear in his side either. That's not what it was. Do you see what that is? These are things Satan mounts against you, and the Lord permits those things to be against you so that you will not be edified above that which you really are. Because listen, when people come back and they have all this good stuff to say about you, that will make a difference in your mindset. It doesn't matter who you are. It's going to blow up your head. And then when you say something, it can be the dumbest thing in the world. People are going to say, I believe it. No. See, that's when you have lost people. That's why I don't like people saying that with me either. No, don't say that with me. You better go to the Word of God. Paul knew he was flesh and he was fallible. He said, I'll keep the infirmities for the sake of Christ, so that people will actually eat the word of Christ, not eat the words of Paul. And sure enough, there was a fight over Paul's the greatest. Oh, no, this one's the greatest apostle, and all this nonsense that goes on even today. People get attitudes. They get carried away with attitudes. They get angry and upset with attitudes. Well, I'm just not going to just stop. I don't want to hear him anymore. I want to hear that one. Right? They're still hearing flesh. I'll tell you this. The worst person can speak the words of Christ out of their mouth, and I will hear the words of Christ. A rock could speak, and I could hear the gospel from that rock, because I'm listening for the words of Christ, not the words of man. I already know the words of man. You know the words of man. That's not what I'm listening for. I'm trying to hear the words of Christ. And Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, and a stranger they will not follow. Remember, he said he could turn any rock into a son of Abraham. He did make a donkey speak, right? So we're going to watch how we operate, qualify things, and what we have heard. The Bible says, be careful how you hear. And this is why context is so important, so that we can hear the truth. We can't run away with a phrase and then make up our own definition to it and say, this is what I think it is. So it's best to know what it actually is. What Paul was actually communicating, these words of a man given to you. And it's good to know what they communicate. 9 times out of 10, you can relate to it. Then your faith is built up in the word. Why? Because you know they're telling the truth. God didn't call us to be grumpy. Each day is a day of renewal. You're brand new today. This is not yesterday. You're brand new today. Everything in this day is new. Nothing is old. Everything is new. No one is saved by proof. No one is saved by evidence. You're saved by grace, but you follow by faith. If they would have seen that, they would have followed him purely by proof. And by proof, they would have followed. That's not how you follow Christ. You don't follow him by proof. You know what happens if you were to follow anybody by proof? It's only a matter of time before you need more proof. See, when you follow somebody by proof, as soon as something happens you don't agree with, you fall away. If all of us were related, and I did something extraordinary that proved I was worthy to speak on this microphone, you guys would say, okay, he's worthy to do that. As soon as I do something that many of you don't agree with, you, see, I knew it. He wasn't worth it. Let me walk away. That you walk away. So anybody who walks by proof is easily going to walk away by proof again. Do you guys understand? As soon as you don't agree with something, you're gone. Those who walk by faith are looking beyond the natural. And because they're looking beyond the natural, they're not drawn or turned away by what they see, but they're drawn by something internal. Do you see how that works? So that means you can see the impossible, but you're not turned away by the impossible, because you're drawn by something internal. You may say something like, I can just feel something different about this. And you follow for that reason. You're not following by what you see. Because if you could perceive many things that happened around Christ, it just looked like it wasn't authorized. To see somebody go into the temple and defile the sacred grain, that looks like it's in contradiction to the word of God. That's what it looks like. So those who were following him by proof, often they walked away. In the Gospels, you can see this. Those who would hang around because they saw a miracle often walked away because they saw a defilement of those decrees of the Most High. Based on what they perceived by the eye, they did follow or walk away. They did. Or they followed him to get something out of him, because Jesus said, after he fed the crowds, he said, you're following me because I fed you. He said, don't follow me. You're following me to get your bellies full, because your bellies are full. You found out you can get food, and so you're going to follow me to continue to get that. He said, don't follow this gospel. Don't follow me for your stomach's sake. And then he told them, he said, my meat is to do the will of the Father. That's what he said, my meat. In other words, he related that same hunger, that same security they liked as far as having a full belly. He related that to his life, saying that what makes me content, what fulfills me, is to do the will of the Father. But he straight told them, you're following me because I fed you. You're going to get hungry again. And by following me, you can eat again. That's one less thing you have to worry about. Don't follow me for that. And he told it, don't follow him because he can impart something to you to make your flesh feel okay. Stop doing that. Follow him because you desire. See, I follow Christ because I desire to do the will of the living God through Christ in this earth. So you know what that means? I don't have to receive any miracles, any special treatment, anything. I don't have to receive any of that stuff to follow Christ. I'm not deterred. I don't get grumpy or anything else when life falls apart. My life has fallen apart plenty of times, but my spirit stays intact. Thank you, Lord. You know how many times I've self-destructed? You guys have no idea. See, I'm not one of those people who said, well, you know, the devil attacked me here. No, he didn't. Most of the stuff that happened in my life, I did it. He didn't do it. I did it. I did it because of my greed, because of something I wanted, because I thought that was way out, this, that, and the other. He didn't do it. I did it. See, I have a habit of taking responsibility over my life. I accept all this. I did that stuff. That's self-destructive. Premeditated sin. Nobody tricked me into sinning. I did it. I'm also aware of that. And because I'm aware of that, I don't really repeat it. because I have no taste for it. I'm going to follow Christ. I'm going to learn his ways. I'm going to become part of the family for real. Not just somebody professing everything, but the Bible says signs and wonders follow the gospel. That means you're healed. If I could house the gospel, that means every time I depart something to you from that gospel, your life is supposed to change. You are the fruit of all of my labors. You are. Not my own prosperity. You are. How you end up is the proof of my worth. Do you guys understand that? If you're not learning anything, you're just being entertained. That's not fruit. That's entertainment. If your life changes and you're now reading about the Lord and you have a relationship with Christ and you're growing with Christ, you are my fruit. Just like your children can sometimes be your fruit. See, at the end of life is when you find out how well you did. You're not going to find out in between. But if I can take a person who refuses to hear everybody else, and the Lord gives me a way to reach the person through simple love, then I've actually done something. My life is being used for something useful. In that way, if I were to wield faith, it would not be by what I think. I wouldn't do things by what I think or what I see. I do it by decree of the Lord. I do it by a way of love and love only. Never by my own judgment, my own timing, what I see and discern and this, that, and the other. I wouldn't do anything based upon that. Because I don't trust that right now. Have you ever looked at a person and said, well, they shouldn't be upset? I've never said that. How many of you have said that? How many of you have been compromised because you thought that thought? I'm incapable of thinking that thought. I really am. I can never look at a person and say, well, they shouldn't be upset about it. I can't do that. I don't understand that one. In other words, the basis of that logic is not in me. The basis of that spirit is not in me. I cannot do that. I've always looked at another person, and then I reflect upon myself saying, I can do better. When people are offended, you know, when they get offended sometimes in COT, I always look upon myself and say, I could have communicated that better. I never put the blame on you. See, because if I'm speaking to somebody who does not have the wisdom to comprehend certain things, then I'm the dummy. If I'm trying to push a point to people who can't really hear it, I'm the dodo again. I should have shown them. If they're blind, I should have told them. If they're deaf, I should have shown them. If they're blind and deaf, I should have tried another method. There's always something better I can do. Because love never forces anything. Love never gets an attitude. When somebody does not listen to love, love stands there. Love always stands at the door and it knocks. Do you know that? Love never backs away, nor does it give up. Love is always there. It's there in the beginning. It's there in the end. Love is unmovable. Love is forward moving. It never asks for anything in return, but it's always giving. And see, more and more need to operate by those ways of love. Because to do that is not to mess up somebody else's life. The whole key is not to be intrusive in somebody's life and to realize they have to make an ultimate decision. That decision has to be of them. It cannot be my decision that they are now believing and so they make it too. No, can't be that. It has to be their decision. Which means we have an opportunity and an obligation to demonstrate to a person the truth of things. To show them the truth is to show them darkness and light. That's the truth in it. The truth is not just light. The truth is there's darkness and light. The truth is not just that there are going to be good times. The truth is you would know what good times are unless you had been wounded. The truth is joy everlasting is when you've been close to the pits of hell and close to the gates of death. That's what that is. The more pain you have felt in your life, the more joy you're going to have in the end. Why? Those who have never been in a painful position, they don't know what relief is. Because they've been living in relief, they take it for granted. Every time something happens to you in your life, it is exposed to you the goodness, which is the contrast of what you're in. Because you believe in Christ, the depth of your failure determines the height of your success. The Lord wouldn't take you all the way down unless he were going to put you all the way up. In order to go all the way up, you had to be brought all the way down, or you would not realize that you're all the way up. If you were born at the top of the ladder with a silver spoon in your mouth, how could you ever know that? You were taken for granted. Just like we do in the U.S., we take many things for granted because we're free. We're not fighting like they are in Kabul. We have homes. We nitpick over dust on certain things. Are you kidding? They nitpick over having no roof. Then when they put one board up in the corner, they're saying, I'm so thankful. Now I can sleep and only half my body is going to be soaking wet when it rains. I remember being in a place. This is way overseas. These little boys are about the age of 10. They slept in rice bags. And they protected those rice bags. I was thinking to myself, why are they protecting those rice bags? The canvas bags, you guys know what I'm talking about. They said because if they didn't have those canvas bags, they would freeze it. They would be so cold at night that they would just shudder and they would wake up starving in the morning. But if they had those bags, they wouldn't shiver so bad. That was the first time my heart was truly broken. That was the first time I said, oh my, are you kidding me? Because I had just got done complaining about my, something was on my, at the time, my LBE, and it was causing a bit of a rash or something on my waist because it wasn't fitting right? Could have been a canteen, ammo pouch, whatever it was. Anyway, I had no more complaints after that moment. In fact, I think internally I cried and repented and chasing myself for at least a month. It really broke me. That broke me. That broke me worse than any relationship breakup or anything else. That broke me. It broke me to know that here these small children are aware of these torments, and we never heard of them. How can they smile at any time when they're eating things literally comparable to tree bark? When their stomachs are swollen because of malnutrition, and they're thankful for the smallest, tiniest piece of anything, and yet they still smile. They're still protective. Then they share their little dreams of what they want to be with a smile. And here I am looking at this, knowing that most of them would never be alive to have that dream. And here we are. You know, that helped me out spiritually because it broke me in the flesh. The Lord took me through many of the things that broke me in the flesh. That broke me in the flesh. At that moment, I realized how stupid I was, how arrogant I was, how even with the Word of God, stupid and arrogant I was, imposing my thoughts, my stuff upon somebody else, not knowing their struggles and their battles, what they're going through, how stupid I was, how deceived I was. Since then, I looked for something else, and my way has been different. The Lord sent me a lot of adjustments, a lot of hurting. I mean, hurtful adjustments. He's had me in times of being powerless and everything else. And because of this, I do not desire to intrude into His work. I will never be the expert on His word. He is the expert of His word. His word is everything. I do well to give it to somebody. I am not the co-author. I am not the author. I am not any force behind His word except one who would carry it to somebody else. I realized that. See, it made the Lord's word the most important thing in my life. That's when I finally understood the gospel. And I also understood how that many say they believe in Christ, but they don't agree with His gospel, because they still agree with man and flesh and death and killing. How militant we really are. See, I had to put some things in check. I said, Lord, you gotta go in there and clean me up. My mind is not right. After I left that place, He began the work. When He began the work, I'm glad He waited until after I left, because had He begun that work while I was there, I wouldn't be able to perform certain things I had to perform. His timing is everything. His way is perfect. His outcome is pure. If we trust in that, we'll not intrude into that work He's doing, but we will seek to complement His work by carrying His message. We're not the scholars of His message. No, that's not what we are, because we did not author that message. We're but children trying to understand an encyclopedia, but we can pass it on to somebody else, and the Lord can show them directly what is what, and He does this through how we live. For those of you who do not wish to intrude upon the gospel of Jesus Christ, you don't want to own it. You don't want to be the one who's known to know it, but you want to carry it to somebody else because you understand it makes a difference in their lives. It's going to save their souls. The Lord's going to teach you a great many things. He's going to show you what suffering truly is. It is not what you initially think it is. It is not what you're perceiving right now, probably. Suffering is a necessity. That's hard to understand when part of your eyes are closed, but it's a hard truth. Because we live in the flesh, but it has a beautiful ending because we are eternal. The Lord knows exactly what He's doing, and everything He is doing is flawless. We do well to follow what He is doing, right? People have a number one question when you start talking about things like this, is they'll say, well, why would the Lord allow somebody to suffer? Why would the Lord allow somebody to die? Who has that question? I'm going to answer it in truth. Let me give you guys a small insight in something. Suppose a person had a problem. They didn't share it with a soul. Listen to me. This problem was of such magnitude that if they did not fix this problem, they have no eternal life, but only eternal damnation. Follow me. We don't know what these folks have on the inside of them and what they're struggling with, what they won't forgive. I tell you that where you find bitterness, you're going to find a problem, which is that somebody has an issue forgiving somebody else, and the Lord didn't play when He wrote what He wrote. If you have not forgiven all, your Father in heaven will not forgive you. If He has not forgiven you, if you die, you are going where there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. You don't go with Him. You're not going to the kingdom. You're not going to step foot the kingdom. If you're an adulterer, if you're a liar, if you're a thief, you're not going to step foot the kingdom. And the Lord's working these things out in us. So when the harsh conditions come, some of us are stern, we're strong, we keep our ways until we're broken. And when we're broken down so much, you know, we always say this. If there's good in that heart, if they are truly marked by the Lord, we always end up saying the same thing. You know what it is? It doesn't matter how old you are, how young you are. You will say, where have I messed up? You put it all on yourself. And then you begin to reflect for the first time in your life. And you begin to see deeper and deeper and deeper. And then all of a sudden you start remembering, oh my Lord, I said this against that person. I never forgave that person. You start searching the deep things. things that can actually keep you out of eternal life. Because when a person finds that, there's no need for the suffering. You belong to Christ. You were bought with a price. You're not going to suffer just to suffer. We don't serve some evil father. We serve a good father. There's a purpose behind every... If you stub your toe, there's a purpose behind it. There's a purpose behind everything. And the Lord said that all who have come to me, the Father hath given me, and I will in no wise cast out. He is raising us. He's going to ensure that you do not perish. And he's doing it the perfect way, not our way. We don't understand it all. We see what's on the surface. We think we know what's going on the surface. We don't. I tell you what, I suffered extraordinarily for 2 years. One day short of that 2 years would have messed up the whole thing. It took 2 years of suffering for me to hear all of what I needed to hear, for certain things to manifest. But then the Lord, near the end of it, bestowed a peace I cannot explain to you. It only came through that massive suffering. It was peace because it was understanding. When the Lord gives you the reasons why things take place, that's when peace comes in. Do you know that? We run around, we have no peace because we don't know why certain things happened. The world has convinced you you need closure. That's what the world told you. Your Father in heaven never told you that. That's some world psychology. That's witchcraft. For a person to even believe they need closure, it's witchcraft. Closure comes from men. It comes from the world. It comes from your flesh and emotion. It is something you'll never find. It's something you think you need. And when you think you get it, you think you're fixed, but you're not. You need the truth, not closure. Not the truth of why somebody died. Not the truth of why some accident happened. No, you need clarity of spirit. You need an identity. If a person never needs closure, that means their identity is locked to something in this world. If I trust the Father in heaven for all things, I will never ever need closure because I trust him who is permitting all things to take place. He gave me my role. He told me what to fight for. I'll do so with all my heart. But when I find myself powerless in a situation I cannot control, it's all on him. He didn't give me power to change it. It's not mine, it's his. And I trust him with it. I fight those things he's given me power to fight and direction to fight. I do things that are within my control. I pray for those things he brings to my attention. If it does not bring to my attention, I can't pray for it. Just as sure as the angels are watching the places in your life you're unaware of, so is the Lord handling all those things we have no idea. The fight we have before us is a fight that's been shown to you. Listen, when you go out and find a bunch of information, you involve yourself in fights that either don't exist or are certainly not yours. But you feel you have a responsibility. There was a lot of innocence before the internet. You know why? Because you only dealt with those things that were before you. When the internet was introduced, you began to share everybody else's problems. See, no one ever told you the spiritual principle behind knowing everybody else's business. If I know everybody's business in COT, if I suddenly find that out through man, not spiritually, is it my fight or is it not? That can confuse a person. You end up fighting everything and you will wear yourselves out. Look what you're dealing with. You're not dealing with your fight anymore. You're not dealing with just giving the gospel to somebody else. You're dealing with somebody else's story. Somebody could call you, contact you and say, you know what? Such and such happened. I've been dealing with this for weeks. All of a sudden you have a burden on you. You have no power to fix, but you'll take it upon yourself and deal with the consequences of that weight. Somebody else will contact you do the same thing. Listen, what's your business is what the Father gave you power to fix. How many cars are in the world? Quite a bit, right? You may only have a key to a few. Those are the cars you have power over. Do you understand? You don't have power over the rest of the cars you have no key to. There are lots of cars, but you don't have all the keys to those cars. The cars you're responsible for, you have the keys to, not the ones you don't have the key to. So a car could be right beside you. You don't have the keys to it. It could be on fire. It could be on fire. What can you do? If you had no water hose or anything else, what can you do? You're going to get in your car and move it away from that car that's burning up. That's what you're going to do because you have no power to fix that. You got to go. Insurance will handle that. I want you guys to think about that. How many situations do you involve yourselves with every single day? You're sending text messages. Everybody else can text you. You can have a good day. Somebody will send you a text and give you some devastating news about their life. All of a sudden, your life is affected. Many of you get something bad from somebody else that has nothing to do with your household, and then you get an attitude with those in your household because of somebody else's issue. You tell somebody in your house, be quiet, I'm trying to think about something, but you're thinking about something in somebody else's household. That's not your responsibility. You're becoming a Martha, and you're heavy laden. It's disobedient to be heavy laden, especially if you know the Lord, because he said, cast those cares upon him. Pray from a perspective of love with charity. You will not go wrong. Leave the details up to him. There's so many things that you have no power to change. If somebody else is going through a bad marriage, You don't know who is the culprit in the marriage. You don't know how to pray for it and pray from a perspective of love. For you guys who know about a bad marriage means you're either about to have some experience with it or have had experience with it. Based upon the truth of your heart, then pray out of the love of your heart. Don't sit there and dissect the issue and try to be like a scientist. Don't emulate the scientific theory with the Word of God. Don't do that. Or the scientific method with the Word of God. Don't do that. Simplify your thoughts. Don't entertain confusion and chaos. Don't sit there and look at both sides and say, I don't know what to do, because then you become overwhelmed. First of all, it's not your relationship. You cannot step into somebody else's relationship and tell people how to feel. So you're powerless from many different respects. It's not yours to do something about. You're messing with a relationship, which is the Father's business in the first place. When you pray, pray out of your heart for what you think, for what you believe, for what your experience tells you is the best. But I'm telling you, the Lord will handle all the details. Life and death is not based upon you or me or anybody else. That's not what it's based upon. We can complement the will of God through prayer, or we cannot. And when it comes to the children responding, if we collectively pray to the Lord to do something to this land, the Lord can act even when he had no plans to. Why? Because we are his children, and we collectively requested that. If it does not get in the way of his will, he'll change it for our sakes. He'll do it for our sakes. He already said he would. You're Christians. You have born-again spirits. You have flesh, yes, but you no longer live your life by flesh. Now, to not live your life by flesh is not to move left or right based upon how you feel. It's not based upon how you feel anymore. It's not based upon how things feel anymore. And if you're living your life like that, you're living it by flesh, not the spirit. We live our lives by truth, which means it can feel awful, but we move by way of the truth. You can feel bad about somebody, but what is the spiritual truth about the situation? Something can look good, but what is the spiritual truth of that situation? Not how you feel. Your feeling is for your flesh and for things of flesh, like the world. Your discernment, knowing good from evil, internally by way of the spirit, that's the true discernment. But it's for your spiritual walk. There are a lot of times when something is spiritually sound, but it feels bad. Of course it does, because if your flesh believes it can be harmed by it, and things are indeed telling you you can be harmed by this, the Lord tells us to walk right into the middle of the hornet's nest. Your flesh will say, don't do that, dummy. You're going to get stung. You see the conflict? That's why the flesh and the spirit do war against one another continually, because the flesh is always trying to save itself, yet the spirit is walking by faith. And it says, well, the consequences do not matter. And your flesh is saying, are you crazy? It does matter. It hurts. And your spirit says, trust God. And your flesh says, you remember the last time you got hurt. See, so it's a contradiction. It's time for you to start working through that contradiction, not living your life by how situations feel, but how spiritually sound they are. Begin to operate by spiritual principle. When you do that, you resist the devil. The devil will speak to you through your flesh, through feeling, through emotion, through all sorts of things. And if you don't believe me, you felt right about that last relationship that almost cost you your life. Oh, it felt right, all right, but it was not right. If you really trust him, then you'll also trust his word. And if you really trust his word, you'll trust the verses that says nothing man can do will stop his work he's doing with you. Say, for example, the Lord had to work with you another 20 years. That means somebody could come up and try to poison you for 20 years and you would not die. Nothing is going to overpower the will of God in your life. And if it's God's will for you to go out there and preach, it doesn't matter how many people poison you, it will not take effect. Listen, we all know the weapon formed against us will not prosper. That means the weapon will form, but it will not prosper. That means you're going to be exposed to many things, because if people are skittish about the vaccine, there's something coming they cannot escape. And what are they going to do? Hide in their homes for the rest of their lives? I'll be the first one that'll go outside when they say don't. I don't care about the consequences. I care about human life. I care about humanity. I care about the gospel of Jesus Christ. And you know what? You're going to see it. You're going to see those who really do walk by faith and those who don't. Suppose the rain was poison. In that day, you're going to see who's walking by faith and who's not. Because those people who really don't trust the Lord, they're saying, I'm not going outside. But I can tell you right now, because I've been tried like this, I will not hesitate to do the will of my Father wherever it takes me. I'll go outside in a tank top. If that's the way it is, that's all I got. That's what I'm wearing. I'm going to do the will of my Father, and nothing's going to get in my way of that. I'm not going to stop because of a poison. See, the Lord gave us a way to obey. He said, submit yourself to earthly authority. So I'm not going to just brazenly break laws to prove a point. That's stupid. I don't want to prove a point. I want people to have the word of God. That's why I protest for the gospel just about every day. How about that? I have an active protest for the gospel every single day. And there's certain things I have done against. You know, I'm really not permitted to speak in the way I do. But who am I going to obey? The Lord or man? I will obey the Lord. You'll never know the cost If I paid anything, you'll never know the cost. You know why? It's not important. What's important is the word, not any price I pay. I don't believe in this sensational stuff that most people believe in. I don't believe in that stuff. Having everybody look at you walking a certain way so they can see evidence of this, that. I don't care what anybody sees. I care that another soul is secured in Christ. That's what I care about. People have their view of things, and there's the truth. Most of you don't know the truth. You have your view of things. But I'll tell you this, what touches your neighbor is not to touch you. You guys understand? Now, it rains on the just as well as the unjust. Do you guys know what that means? The overall conditions of the earth, everybody will experience. As far as calamities, you're not to go through them. You could be in your neighborhood. The whole neighborhood could be torn down, blown up, whatever the case is. You would be saved. Some of you, you had to be forced out of where you live because you were too stubborn and you would not move. The Lord has His way. He did not want you in those areas. The Lord doesn't want you so comfortable, your faith would begin to dwindle either. If anything competes with your faith, you can kiss that goodbye, certainly in these days. If the Lord loves you, He will destroy everything that competes with faith. If He loves you, He's not going to have you have something that will destroy you. You're not here to be destroyed. You're here to be redeemed. The gospel, that word gospel means good news. But our walk of faith, we should actually begin to walk by faith, not by sight. Don't walk by what you see. Don't walk by what you feel. Walk by what the word of the Lord says. Walk by His promises and His love. Walk by His decrees, not by ours. There's a mechanism in me, folks, and you have to forgive me for this. It stands against all these formulas that people have. I stand against the formulas they have. But in this day and age, many people are convinced by way of those formulas because it gives you something tangible you can hold on to. You're more prone to trust a formula than you are any word of faith. You're going to have to fight the good fight of faith from this point out, or you could be usurped. You're going to have to trust the word of the Lord without challenge. If you don't understand something in the word, ask your Father in heaven to show you what it is. Don't ever try to solve the Bible like it's a puzzle. It's not a puzzle. It doesn't have puzzle pieces. It's whole. God's word is not fractured. Our words are fractured. God's word is whole. We adopt sayings and things of the world, and we instantly apply it to our spiritual walk. We can't do that anymore. And we have to be careful not to walk in the ways of men in our spiritual walk. Because that's happening too. They're becoming one in the same. Folks, I don't know about you, but I have experienced walking by faith, and I choose it and will yet choose it, even when things are impossible. The Lord is a good Father. He already knows how we think. That's why He sent His Son to forgive you. That's why He sent His Son to die for you and for me. He already knows what we were to become, what we're prone to, what we fall for, what we believe and what we don't believe. He's a good Father. You're here to be redeemed. He showed you what the other side is. Now He's showing you what His spiritual things are. And He's assigning you things as you go along the way. That's an honor, big time. He's going to save and deliver each and every one of us because He said so. He knows how to deliver the righteous. None of you can be tricked into going to hell. And anything you have to do to renounce the Lord, I could break your hearts and talk the truth to you, because I'm going to tell you something. Many of you set Jesus on the back burner to get ahead. We've already done that. Because when somebody is making a statement implying that Jesus has no power, I got a problem. Something is wrong. We have to start qualifying these things based on the word of the Lord, not based on fear of the flesh. We have to get real here. See, we're coming down to the wire where people believe in Christ or not. Because there's a lot of stuff out there on the internet, and they're telling you that Christ is not going to do what He said He's going to do. But the vaccine is going to overpower the blood of the Lamb somehow. That's a lie. There's no truth in that. Nor can the virus overpower the blood of the Lamb. That's a lie. I don't believe those because the Lord said they're lies. Nothing will overpower the blood. Satan did not overcome Christ. Christ overcame the world. So I don't subscribe to anything that would suggest that somehow the Lord Jesus is not King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He has authority over all things. I don't agree with anything that would suggest the otherwise. Now again, if somebody says denounce the Lord or has you, you do some vile act to get something, no, don't do it. Listen, in fact, the Bible says, 3 years ago, I heard many people say this term. Remember what the Bible says? If you try to save your life, you're going to lose it. That's exactly what they were saying 3 years ago. Now they're saying, folks, you better save your own life or you're going to lose it. They're saying the opposite of what the Word is saying. They're saying save your life, perpetuate your life. Do everything to save your life. They're trying to tie in spiritual things with it. But your Father in heaven is in control. Don't you think He can take that virus, COVID-19, and turn it into a cure for your body, for any disease you would ever have. He can do anything he wants to do. Most often we forget that. We hear some scientists say what COVID-19 does in the body. Yes, what it does in somebody's body who's not covered by the blood of the Lamb. And for those who are washed by the blood of the Lamb, it can only do what the Lord permits. Because he has the keys of hell and death in the grave. Nobody else does. But people are doing what they're doing based on fear, not based upon the word of the Lord. They're not asking what the Lord is saying directly to them. They're asking everybody else, is it going to kill me? If you're washed by the blood of the Lamb, you are off limits to demons and everything else. You will have what you invite. But see, now you're starting to find out who believes and who does not. Because if you believe in Christ, then you also believe that nothing's going to overpower him. I do not subscribe to anything that would suggest that Jesus is somehow overthrown. I don't subscribe to that. My Lord, now we see who's going to walk by faith and who isn't. You know what? A lot of Christians, they love the Lord. They do want to walk by faith. But because of the pressure of others, they are in agreement with things they shouldn't be. Pray for them. They need strength to stand on their own, them and the Lord. Holiness is not going to turn its back on you because you choose to do something everybody else does not choose to do, or vice versa. That's not what holiness is. But I'm telling you right now, Jimmy cracked corn, and you know the rest. Because I know what the Lord said he would do, and I trust and believe in that. And the ending is going to be what the Lord writes. There is no human being that will write the final chapter of my book. Only the Lord can do that. No human being can. No demon can. Satan cannot. Only the Lord Jesus can do that. That is my firm stance. And I have not wavered, nor will I waver from that stance. I believe in the outcome decreed of my Lord and Savior Jesus Christ upon my life. I do not believe in the outcome of fear, nor of anybody's speculation, nor of their facts. I don't care if somebody looked me right in the face and say, you're going to die of cancer. And do they tried that? I'm still here. I'm telling you, I've been exposed to just about everything. I was supposed to die of many things in my life, and not one of them took me out of here. Because you're not going anywhere until the Lord says you're done. You've finished your race. And for the unbelievers, they're not going anywhere until the Lord says, I will no longer knock at that person's door. Even they won't go anywhere until the Lord is done knocking at their door. But let me emphasize, if something required me to denounce Christ as my personal Savior, I'm telling you right now, I will not denounce my Lord and Savior. I won't denounce him by my own actions, by my faith, by mouth, by life, or by any other means. See, I compromised a few times in my life. I've been around people who did not believe in the Lord, and I kept quiet because they didn't believe. That's denouncing him before men, and a question was asked of me. And I laughed with the rest of them, not making any waves. That's denouncing him before men. I'll never do those things again. It does not matter where I am. If I ever get an unction to pray, it's exactly what I'm going to do. Hopefully, more and more will make decisions based upon faith and not by fear. No longer being afraid or being hated by so many in the world because they love the Lord's ways and they trust his outcome. There are a lot of people today that cannot talk against the narratives about COVID-19 or the vaccine, nor can they talk for it. Based on what side they're on, they had to be loyal to it, but they have no job. They will fire you based upon your position. Well, Jimmy cracked corn.